Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fierce Ambition, The Life and Legend of War Correspondent Maggie Higgins, by Jennet Conant, read by EJ Lavery. I wouldn't be here if there were no trouble. Trouble is news, and gathering it is my job. Marguerite Higgins. Prologue. We did all kinds of crazy things that I never would have done by myself. But, you know, you don't want to be shown up by a beautiful young lady. Peter First, Stars and Stripes correspondent. On Sunday, April 29, 1945, Marguerite Higgins was at the 3rd Infantry Division command post outside Augsburg in southern Germany, trying to figure out a way to get to Dachau. Less than 20 miles of unsecured road separated her from the infamous concentration camp, which was about to be freed by American forces. Maggie intended to be there when the tanks rolled in. A 24-year-old unknown cub reporter with the New York Herald Tribune, she had teamed up a few weeks earlier with Sergeant Peter First, a combat-seasoned correspondent with the Army newspaper Stars and Stripes. First's chief attraction was that he was in the possession of a jeep, which meant he could take her where she wanted to go without some military minder ordering her to the rear. Hitchhiking a ride with a young soldier reporter, she had covered the 3rd as it tore through Bavaria in pursuit of the fleeing enemy, capturing the Nazi citadel at Nuremberg after a furious house-to-house siege, followed by the astonishing bloodless capitulation of Augsburg. The latter was orchestrated in part by First, who had called ahead to the Burgermeister and warned him that resistance was futile. When a German emissary later brought word that the Burgermeister, with the help of the local anti-Nazi underground, was prepared to hand over the city to the Americans, Augsburg fell without a fight on April 28. Delighted at the outcome, the two correspondents congratulated themselves for their part in such thrilling wartime exploits as taking cities by telephone. Early the next morning, Maggie, all smiles, had tried to persuade the commander of the 3rd Division, Major General John Wilson, Iron Mike, O'Daniel, to fly her to Dachau in a spotter plane. She might as well have asked for the moon. A tough-talking soldier of the old school, he told her bluntly that it was a good way to get killed. What was left of the Wehrmacht, the armed forces of Nazi Germany, was in their sector. The 15th Corps, the 7th Army's major tactical unit, was moving south with the mission of taking Munich, and it had 3 of its infantry divisions, the 45th, the 42nd, and the 3rd, in line. O'Daniel's orders were to push to Munich, where the enemy might be preparing to make a last, desperate stand. The other 2 infantry divisions were targeted to pass through the Dachau area, but the concentration camp was not his military objective. Undeterred, Maggie put the proposition to First. Let's drive to Dachau. He looked at her and decided. It was worth the risk. Many of the neighboring villages were draped with white flags. In the prevailing mood of surrender, he thought the odds were pretty good that they could make it across the enemy-held territory in one piece. The tricky part was that no one seemed to know the exact location of the camp, just that it was in or near the town. But First could see Maggie was ready and eager, and he did not want to let her down. Then the driver of a half-truck armored vehicle, who had overheard them discussing their plans, offered to lead the way ahead of the troops. They set off immediately, racing ahead of the 42nd, Rainbow, and 45th, Thunderbird, divisions, hoping to be the first reporters on the scene. The liberation of Dachau would be front-page news. For Maggie, it would also be a huge scoop, a chance to break the biggest story of her career in the waning days of the conflict. The Third Reich was almost finished. Hitler's soldiers were in headlong retreat. She was running out of war and out of time. She had been tipped off that the Americans would be closing in on Dachau that day. But the military situation was fluid, and the rapid and confused advance, also spearheaded by 2 combat commands from the 20th Armored Division, encountered more resistance than expected. No one was more surprised than Maggie to discover that a battle for a neighboring village was not yet over. And instead of converging on the camp with their triumphant troops, she and First were staging an ad hoc liberation operation of their own. While Dachau was no great distance on the map, it turned out to be an interminable, white-knuckle drive. Maggie felt very exposed in their open jeep with stars and stripes stenciled in large letters on the front, a fluttering American flag on the side, announcing their allegiance. She held her breath as they rolled past group after group of heavily armed Wehrmacht soldiers, bearing rifles, pistols, and grenades. The bedraggled infantrymen seemed to know the war was all but over, and willingly offered up their guns, piling them in the back of the jeep until it was full. Even after the soldiers were disarmed, Maggie's sense of danger did not abate. She had not been in the field long enough to feel comfortable around so many weapons. Dressed in a bulky German army jacket and fatigues to disguise the fact that she was a woman, her blonde curls tucked into a fur-lined hat with ear flaps, she was less afraid of being shot than that one of the grenades rattling around the back of the vehicle would explode. When they reached the quaint, cobblestone town of Dachau, they stopped to reconnoiter. They could hear the sound of artillery fire in the north, where at least one of the American divisions was still engaged. The local townspeople were friendly, however, and some even cheered them on. The civilians they questioned told them that white flags had been spotted flying from buildings on the southern edge of the camp. Encouraged, they decided to head in that direction. A quick end run around the fighting, and they would be there. While passing through town, they encountered five U.S. Army jeeps belonging to Brigadier General Henning Linden, the stocky 53-year-old assistant commander of the 42nd Division, and his men. Linden had orders to take a small reconnaissance group and secure the concentration camp. His instructions were to keep the inmates contained and frozen in place until medical help arrived and the necessary relief supplies could be brought in by support columns. With his party was a sixth jeep bearing two Belgian journalists, accompanied by two former French prisoners of war, who knew how to get to Dachau and offered to serve as guides. Maggie and First joined the caravan and fell in behind the lead jeep, where Linden's aide-de-camp, Lieutenant William Cowling, acted as scout. With the assistance of the French POWs, they had no difficulty finding their way. By the time they approached the outer edge of the camp that afternoon, the tanks of the 45th Division had already arrived at the western end and were moving in. As the sprawling Dachau complex came into view, Maggie could see it included dozens of administrative and factory buildings, barracks, officer quarters, and training grounds. She scanned the horizon, searching for any sign of the barbed wire enclosure where the prisoners were kept. It was the most segregated and secure part of the camp, a separate walled-off compound ringed by guard towers, electrified fencing, and along the western side, a canal that functioned as a moat. Unlike Linden and his men, Maggie had some idea of what lay ahead. At the time, most American soldiers knew almost nothing about the concentration camps, beyond the rumors of terrible conditions and mistreatment. Rumors many, including Maggie herself, had tended to discount as exaggerated wartime propaganda about the enemy. But as one of the first reporters inside Buchenwald, which she had toured shortly after it was liberated on April 11, she had seen firsthand that all the tales about the Nazis' extreme brutality were true. Her story about the unimaginable horror at Buchenwald had helped to reveal to the world the reality of the concentration camps as a cold-blooded operation designed to degrade, torture, and exterminate untold thousands of inmates. Now, she was intent on being the reporter who broke the news of the Nazi atrocities at Dachau as well. From what she and First had gathered at headquarters, it was going to be grim. One of the oldest concentration camps in Germany, Dachau was established in 1933 to hold upwards of 5,000 political prisoners who had voiced opposition to Adolf Hitler's regime. But the numbers had quickly swelled as the Nazis began rounding up Jews, Jehovah's Witnesses, and homosexuals, as well as ever-increasing numbers of foreign nationals from occupied territories, so that the inmate population soon far exceeded the camp's maximum capacity. With Germany on the brink of collapse, the conditions in the camp had steadily deteriorated, with the situation becoming desperate in recent months. There were rumors that the food and water had run out some days ago, and the prisoners, who had staged a revolt, were trying to hang on until help arrived. Maggie steeled herself for the depths of human misery they would encounter. As they drew nearer, she was hit by the smell. It was the gut-churning stench of decay. Outside the perimeter of the Dachau complex, on a railroad siding that led into the camp, was a long stationary train consisting of some 40 boxcars. Dead bodies spilled out of the open doors and gondola cars. Men, women, and children had been packed in like cattle and left to die of hunger, thirst, and disease in the locked carriages. The grotesque cadavers, with their distorted features, bony arms and legs protruding at odd angles from ragged blue and gray striped prison uniforms, told of the agony of their final journey. Alongside the tracks, there were mounds of corpses, the rotting remains of those who had been hauled out and shot. They had been piled in heaps, waiting to be carted away and buried, or burned in the crematorium. Trash, excrement, and scraps of clothing littered the ground. Sickened by the sight, she bent double and wrenched. General Linden gave the order to press on. They turned right and drove up the wide avenue that led to the arched main entrance of Dachau, topped by a large wreathed swastika and imposing stone eagle. They made their way deeper into the camp, where they encountered a small reception party. Waving a makeshift flag of truce, a white sheet tied to a broomstick, was the acting commandant of the camp, Lieutenant Heinrich Wicker, accompanied by his aide and by a Swiss civilian, Victor Maurer, a member of the International Red Cross. Wicker, a strapping young officer who was smartly attired in his helmet and uniform, saluted with a Heil Hitler, clicked his heels, and stated that he was ready to turn over the camp and all of its prisoners. His stiff, formal demeanor and arrogant expression so outraged Maggie that she slapped him. First offered to act as interpreter. Born and raised in Germany, he had fled with his family after the Nazi regime began its persecution of Jews and later emigrated to the U.S. As the American soldiers and reporters gathered around the acting commandant in a semicircle, Wicker explained that he had been put in charge only the previous day, and that most of the garrison, members of the SS, or Schutzstaffel, Hitler's elite guard, had absconded. Only a small contingent remained behind, about 50 soldiers, to man the machine gun placements in the guard towers. First told Wicker that General Linden would accept the official surrender of the camp on behalf of the American Army. While the terms were being negotiated, First asked the acting commandant to assign someone to take him and his colleague directly to the inmate enclosure. Maggie, hovering on the periphery, was close enough to hear the conversation, but not so close as to attract notice. She knew that First, wary of the high-voltage fencing, had requested an escort as a precaution, because he had no intention of trying to open the prison gates himself. Just then, they heard the sputter of a machine gun coming from somewhere on their left flank. Everyone dove for cover. First thought that they were being fired on by the SS guards. As soon as the shooting stopped, he and Maggie took off in a hurry in their jeep, with Cowling and one of his MPs perched on the hood. A German prisoner served as their escort. Everything happened so fast that no one agrees on exactly what took place next. And over the decades, it has been the subject of varyingly self-serving accounts from all involved. According to Maggie and First, A group of SS guards suddenly appeared beneath one of the concrete watchtowers. Looking up, the reporters saw that the observation platform was crammed with more sentries, rifles at the ready. There was no point in trying to run. With a show of false bravado, Maggie called out to them in German, "Kommen Sie hier!" Come here. They obediently came toward us, she recalled, hands in the air. Then another group of a dozen or more guards descended from the tower. A total of 20 SS guards approached and forfeited their weapons. Cowling had the men remanded into custody. The lieutenant and the two journalists then got back in the jeep, and with their German escort in tow, they crossed a small concrete bridge over the canal that bordered the enclosure. Directly in their path, a man lay dead, a bullet through his head. The German prisoner dismounted and shoved the body aside. They proceeded straight to the two-storied Jurhaus, or entrance building, that served as the main guard post of the compound, and without delay went through the heavy wrought iron gate, emblazoned with the Nazi slogan, "Arbeit macht frei." There was not a soul in the yard when the gate opened, Maggie wrote in the Herald Tribune. But the minute the two of us entered, a jangled barrage of, "Are you Americans?" in about 16 languages came from the barracks 200 yards from the gate. An affirmative nod caused pandemonium. Tattered, emaciated men, weeping, yelling, and shouting, "Long live America," swept toward the gate in a mob. Those who could not walk limped or crawled. In the wild outpouring of joy that followed, the prisoners sprinted toward her, running, falling, tripping, getting up, and rushing forward again. One flung his arms around her in an enthusiastic embrace that lifted her off her feet. Another enveloped first in a huge bear hug. The ecstatic inmates picked up their liberators and tossed them in the air, hoisting them from shoulder to shoulder and parading them around the camp, too excited to detect a soprano voice of protest rising above their raucous cheers. The atmosphere of hysteria produced unbelievable strength in men who looked too weak to stand, and Maggie was quickly overwhelmed by the welcoming stampede. One man, who had his arms around her neck and was kissing her effusively, heard her cry out that she could not breathe. He hastily disengaged and fended off the others. Mon Dieu, c'est infâme, he exclaimed in French.
Pardon, madame.
A Catholic priest and a deputy of Auguste Cardinal Hond, primate of Poland, he was deeply chagrined by his mistake. Once Maggie had wriggled out of the priest's embrace, off came the goggles and helmet. Golden locks fell down and a pert, made-up face was revealed, recalled Niren Gun, a Turkish reporter who was one of the internees in the yard. The officer was a woman, a war correspondent, Marguerite Higgins of the New York Herald Tribune. After half an hour of being tossed around by the delirious throng, the rattled and badly bruised reporters were relieved to see the American soldiers at the gate. When General Linden spotted Maggie in a crush of prisoners, all of them clamoring to tell her their name and nationality, he bellowed,
"What the hell are you doing in there? Don't you know the place is raging with typhus? Come here."
There were 33,000 half-starved, lice-infested, traumatized prisoners incarcerated at Dachau, many ill with typhoid. The barracks were filled with the sick and dying. Linden had to keep the POWs locked up until the medics arrived. If the prisoners got out and spread the epidemic throughout the countryside, it would be a disaster. Inside the compound, tensions were running high. The prisoners were working themselves into a fever pitch at the prospect of their imminent liberation. A crowd by the fence was on the verge of rioting after being told they could not leave because of the quarantine edict. When Maggie approached the gate, Linden reached through the grillwork and grabbed her by the collar, shaking her hard in an effort to knock some sense into her. At that moment, a sea of inmates surged forward, flattening her against the gate and winding her for several seconds until she managed to extricate herself with the help of Cowling, who had entered the yard ahead of her. "God damn it to hell!" she swore, her initial astonishment giving way to anger as she twisted loose. Finding her voice, she shouted at Lyndon at the top of her lungs, giving vent to all the pent-up fear and anguish of the past few hours. "Lay off. Let go of me. I've had my typhus shots. I'm in here doing my job." She went back to work, determined to interview as many of the prisoners as she could. She had been told that some of the greatest brains of Europe had spent more than 11 years interred at Dachau. She was not going to leave until she learned the fate of several important political and religious hostages. Léon Blum, the last premier of France, Kurt von Schuschnigg, the former chancellor of Austria, Prince Leopold of Prussia, and Martin Niemöller, a prominent anti-Nazi Lutheran pastor. If they were found alive and rescued, it would make headlines around the globe. Recognizing that the situation was fraught with danger, Lyndon directed his men to remove the reporters and to restore order in the enclosure area, which was now filled with thousands of shoving, screaming prisoners. Hundreds had climbed onto the roofs of the barracks. Some were frantically trying to break out via the Jurhaus building, and the windows and doors had been burst open and people poured through. By now, soldiers of the 45th Division, Lieutenant Colonel Felix Sparks' 3rd Battalion of the 157th Infantry Regiment, had reached the Jurhaus gate. Sparks' task force, which also had orders to secure the camp, had been busy clearing buildings and capturing small clusters of German troops. The shots the reporters had assumed were fired by the SS probably came from Sparks' platoon, which had fought its way from the other side of the Dachau complex. The shots could also have come from the coal yard, where several of Sparks' men, enraged by what they had seen at the death train, opened fire on a large group of captured SS guards, killing at least 17 and wounding as many as 75. By the time Sparks got control of his men and made his way to the Jurhaus gate, the prisoners had worked themselves into a frenzy. In response to the growing violence in the compound, Sparks ordered his men to fire their weapons in the air to quell the bedlam. Over the next hour, soldiers of the 42nd and 45th managed to push all the prisoners back inside the enclosure, seal it off, and install their own armed guards. Once the crowd had quieted down, Lyndon agreed to allow the journalists to see the rest of the camp. Even as darkness fell and first urged that it was time to go, Maggie kept on reporting. She kept searching for the special prisoners until an inmate told her they had been evacuated days earlier. When at last she and First departed, it was late, and the roads were clogged by convoys. At midnight, when the RCA transmitter shut down, they were still miles away from the press center. She had cut it too close and missed her deadline. It would be another 16 hours before she could file again. She spent the night dozing fitfully by the side of the Autobahn, cursing the stubbornness that had resulted in a rookie error. However, the next morning, instead of heading straight back to the press center, she could not resist taking a slight detour to Munich, less than 10 miles away, to watch the fabled Bavarian city where Hitler rose to power fall to the Seventh Army. The Herald Tribune ran two front page stories, datelined April 29, delayed, and April 30, both carrying Marguerite Higgins' byline. The stories, written in a hurry, did neither event justice. Still, her stark eyewitness account of the liberation of Dachau was the exclusive of a lifetime, and it made her a star overnight. The other journalists who were there that day also wrote personal stories for their respective publications, but none was as dramatic as Maggie's. She had cast herself as a prime player in one of the most momentous episodes of the war. Relegating to the accompanying soldiers and their nameless officers only minor walk-on roles, ensuring her own place in history. First's vivid portrayal of her jubilant reception at Dachau was the stuff of legend. In his dispatch for the Stars and Stripes, he described how Higgins, a pretty, blonde war correspondent, was the first person to announce to the inmates that they were free. She shouted the glad tidings in German, French, and English to the prisoners, who were crowded around her with tears streaming down their worn and bearded faces. He wrote that the men, most little more than walking skeletons, fell to their knees in gratitude, grasping her hands and kissing the dusty ground at her feet in one of the maddest and most heart-rending liberation scenes of the war. A few days later, First learned he was being called back to the Rome Bureau. He and Maggie went their separate ways. Their journalistic partnership and road romance were short-lived, but, emboldened by his fearless approach, a brand of courage she adopted as her own, Maggie had succeeded in establishing her reputation as a nervy and relentless reporter who, as her editor put it, covered the news with a single-mindedness and determination that brooked no interference. In only 8 weeks at the front, she had reeled off an amazing string of page one stories and made her byline known to the newspaper's hundreds of thousands of readers in Europe and the U.S. The Tribune would take to trumpeting the daring exploits of their girl correspondent behind enemy lines, establishing a practice that, for better or worse, would become a hallmark of her career. From then on, the mere fact of Maggie's presence in the combat zone would be almost as newsworthy as the events she covered. To cap it all off, she and First were awarded campaign ribbons for outstanding service with the armed forces under difficult conditions. Maggie later learned the recommendation was made by her erstwhile foe, General Linden. During the worst chaos at the camp, when several prisoners flung themselves against the fence in an attempt to get out and were instantly electrocuted, she rose to the occasion and helped to alert the inmates to the danger. Taking over the loudspeaker system, she warned of the lethal current and urged calm until First and another officer found someone to flip the master switch and cut the power. Within 24 hours of Dachau's liberation, Hitler was dead. A little more than a week later, the war in Europe was over. On May 8, the night of Germany's total surrender, Maggie attended a victory party at a magnificent castle near Salzburg, where Joachim von Ribbentrop, Hitler's foreign minister, had once hosted important guests. Schloss Kleisheim was now the palatial headquarters of the 3rd Division, and O'Daniel had invited all his regimental and battalion commanders, plus the half-dozen correspondents who had been covering them, to celebrate the end of the war. At exactly 1 minute after midnight, they all went out on the balcony and watched as the artillery guns fired into the black sky. For nearly half an hour, red and blue flares and tracer bullets flashed in a patriotic display, and the percussive guns echoed across the valley, while the surrounding mountains roared and shook with the noise. High above in the Obersalzburg, outside the remote village of Berchtesgaden, with its toy-like houses, was the Berghof, Adolf Hitler's beloved alpine retreat. And far above, clinging to a rocky outcrop, was the famous Eagle's Nest, his spectacular mountain eyrie, said to be a 50th birthday present from his inner circle. Days earlier, O'Daniel had superseded his orders and sent the 7th Infantry Regiment to capture Berchtesgaden so that his men would have the honor of taking the Nazi prize. An hour before the Americans arrived, Hitler's SS bodyguards had set fire to the Berghof. All that was left, Maggie wrote, was a gaunt, blazing ruin, The day after they took the Nazi stronghold, she toured the smoldering remains of Hitler's once lavish home, with its cavernous living room and grand marble staircase, now blackened by flame. The enormous picture window was missing, chunks of melted glass on the sill. The bomb-proof cellars, which survived intact, contained great stores of food, liquor, linen, china, and silver, the latter engraved with the monogram AH, used for elaborate dinners. The Nazis, with their mania for tunnels, had honeycombed the hillside with underground bunkers. Some were fitted out as apartments, stuffed with paintings, books, records, photographs, and odd bits of personal memorabilia, which the GIs were busy pilfering as souvenirs. Bypassing the loot, Maggie ran the chalet's major domo to ground and got the lowdown on the Führer's private life and mistress, Eva Braun. It was another fabulous scoop. For Maggie, it was a night of mixed emotions. Since the start of the conflict, she had only one ambition, to be a war correspondent. She had worked her way up at the paper from a lowly stringer to city reporter, paying her dues and proving that she was as good as the boys. After the Normandy landings, she had begged to be sent abroad, knowing it was the last best chance to make her name. In mid-March, she had left the Paris bureau for the front lines in Germany, an untested reporter whose editors still maintained that the combat zone was no place for a woman. Now, it was May 8, VE Day, and the war that had been raging for 5 years had come to an end. The big show was over. There would be no more battles to write about, no conquered cities to cover, no screaming headlines underlined in red. The soldiers she had interviewed earlier that day on the spacious, tree-shaded castle grounds had greeted the news of the armistice with deep relief. But for Maggie, it was a disappointing anticlimax. As she stood there on the balcony in Salzburg, watching the fireworks, it struck her that she was probably the only one there who was not happy at the prospect of going home. Unless she could find another war to cover, the journalistic glory that she had just achieved and so fiercely coveted would soon fade. Peace was the last thing she wanted. 1. Freak. Good candidates for the job are rare. They are usually freaks who have landed headfirst at their goal either by opportunity, hard work, or luck. Most often, luck. Ishbel Ross, Ladies of the Press. Maggie Higgins grew up in a middle-class family in an ordinary middle-class neighborhood in Oakland, California, a city she recalled with scorn, noted for neither character nor excitement. Her craving for the latter was cultivated from an early age by her father, who spoon-fed her tales of his thrilling escapades as a World War I ambulance driver. He joined a field service unit attached to the French army, and later as a flyer. Irresistibly drawn to the action, Lawrence Daniel Higgins abandoned his studies at the University of California to cross the Atlantic to help fight for the Allied cause. When America entered the war in 1917, he answered the call for pilots to darken the skies over Germany, and after completing his flight training with the Lafayette Escadrille, a legendary squadron composed largely of American volunteers, he was commissioned a second lieutenant in the U.S. Army Air Service. He was a tall, strikingly handsome Irishman, whose early manhood was marked by astonishing risk and adventure, an unparalleled experience during which he served alongside men of honor and purpose, bonded with them at the front, and felt his life and work were imbued with the human closeness and magnificence of character that danger sometimes provokes. Like many of his generation, he never got over it. After the war, he could not settle down. Civilian life seemed meaningless. Nothing Larry tried his hand at could ever match the intensity of his time in France. In her father's telling and retelling of his exploits as a flying ace, Maggie perceived his dismay at the flabby routine of their suburban existence. Through some strange twist of fate, the dashing young aviator and his lovely French wife, Marguerite, whom he had chanced upon in the Paris metro during an air raid, had ended up marooned in a drab little house on Chabot Court, a new residential tract on the unfashionable side of Oakland. They lived on a dead-end street, surrounded by matching two-story stucco bungalows with neat little rows of lawns and neat little rows of people, Maggie wrote, with the limited horizons imposed by geography and the genteel poverty that was their lot. Years later, some of her family members and childhood friends would take exception to the uncharitable description of the sleepy cul-de-sac that appeared in her memoir, protesting that Chabot Court was a perfectly respectable, if modest, neighborhood. It was populated by young, upwardly mobile couples who were attracted by the opportunities in Oakland, a fast-expanding city that was home to numerous thriving manufacturing industries. But this was lost on Maggie, who shared Larry's dream of adventure in far-off lands and saw Chabot Court only through his disappointed eyes. Growing up, Maggie adored her father and absorbed his unhappiness, his loneliness, and his longing for the tumult, camaraderie, and daring do of his youth. Larry was a great talker. She listened with wonder to his heart-pounding yarns, the daring maneuvers and close brushes with death. She pored over the many photographs of him in uniform, lovingly framed and on display, leaning against a tilting, rickety-looking biplane. She admired the campaign ribbons and wings on his chest, the Sam Brown belt that wrapped around the shoulder and trim waist of his tunic, and the breeches tucked into high leather boots. He had commanded the skies in his Sopwith Camel, had performed amazing feats, and she burned with pride in him and basked in the light of his reflected glory. To Maggie, her father seemed every bit as gallant and brave as the famous pilot Charles Lindbergh, to whom everyone said he bore more than a passing resemblance. Like Lucky Lindy, he, too, had once returned to a hero's welcome. And so the war became to me the whole complex of things that made my father's eyes shine with emotion, Maggie wrote, and his Irish spirit escaped the humdrum as he talked of the days on the Marne, of the Rhine, of the flights on the line, and of Paris. Always of Paris. In assessing her lifelong affinity for faraway places, she didn't need to look any further than the romantic tales she heard of her parents' early married days. After the armistice of 1918, the newlyweds sailed to the Orient, where her father had secured a job as an assistant freight manager with the Pacific Mail Steamship Company. The decision to go abroad was motivated less by the lure of travel than by Larry's realization that it would be impossible to continue his studies at the Sorbonne and support a French war bride. But that did not prevent Maggie from being enchanted by their picturesque account of life in colonial Hong Kong, then a bustling British port town. The harbor filled with sampans and majestic junks with billowing sails like storybook pirate ships. In her imagination, it was a mysterious, multifaceted jewel of a city, as sparkling as Oakland was dull. It was where Maggie, known as Gree to her family, was born on September 3, 1920. Her doting parents retained a Chinese ama, or nursemaid, as was the custom. And so it was that her first words were in Cantonese. In baby photos, she looks like an exquisite porcelain doll, with her mother's fine features, corn silk hair, and huge sapphire eyes. When, as a 6-month-old infant, she was stricken with malaria, her worried parents whisked her to Dalat, a mountain resort in what was then French Indonesia, later Vietnam, to recover, advised by the doctor that the cool, clear air would work its cure. Later, it would seem prophetic to Maggie of her life's tempestuous course that the family patriarch had met a tragic end in that same part of the world, dooming his heirs to an uncertain fate. Her maternal grandfather, Count Georges de Godard, an aristocratic young officer with the French colonial forces, had died in Indochina in the 1890s after being wounded and contracting a tropical fever. Her mother had been born in scandalous circumstances to the Count, who had offended his titled clan by marrying the fetching Marguerite Piguet, whom he had plucked from peasant stock. Only months after the Count's demise, his young widow died from injuries sustained in a hunting accident. Rejected by the de Godards, the couple's three children, Marguerite and her two older sisters, Genevieve and Juliette, were left penniless and placed in an orphanage. By all accounts, their impoverished Piguet relations came to the rescue. Their maternal grandmother went back to work as a postmistress in Lyon, France, and saw to the upbringing of the girls. But Indochina remained forever a tragic land in the family lore. The Higgins family's Hong Kong odyssey was not nearly as eventful, nor did it last long. Although they could afford to live in relative luxury on Larry's salary, the overcrowding, sanitation problems, and growing unrest made it an unsuitable place to raise a child. Recurrent strikes and anti-imperialist protests threatened the shipping trade. In the fall of 1923, Larry booked their return passage to the U.S. and to California, where he had lived before the war. Looking back, Maggie wrote that it must have been difficult for her parents to be suddenly transported to the dreary Oakland suburb that was so removed from the colorful expatriate life they had enjoyed. Her father, a feisty, red-headed Irish charmer with undeniable presence, was soon accepted, despite a tendency to drink too much and occasional displays of temper, as on the day he became so enraged at his daughter that he chased her down the street while clad only in his shorts. Although he suffered from black moods, and there was never a time he did not view the world through a veil of tears and predict approaching doom, Larry was immensely likable. He was a striver with a steadying sense of discipline and direction. He had made it the hard way, working his way up from running the local Piggly Wiggly grocery store to managing the Oakland branch of the Bank of Italy, which served San Francisco's large immigrant community. Even though money was tight, he presented himself as a man with prospects. People naturally took to him and gave him the benefit of the doubt. Her mother was a different story. She looked nothing like her American counterparts, with her platinum updo, high heels, and chic clothes copied from the pages of Vogue. She was just 18 when she got married and was younger, thinner, and sexier. Being Latin and less inhibited, she compensated for the lack of excitement in life at Chabot Court by inventing crises of her own. As Maggie put it, she was possessed of the French woman's love of le grand drame. Outbreaks of weeping, bursts of gaiety, tipsy solo tangos in the living room, serial flirtations, and fainting spells were all part of her repertoire. During the Depression, when money was short and life especially boring, the fainting spells became more frequent. Maggie could spot one coming on from across the room. Once, her mother collapsed in the midst of a cocktail party, bringing a half dozen concerned guests to their knees, all of them hysterically chafing her hands and bleeding in alarm. Maggie simply got up, excused herself, and walked out of the room. She despised her mother's phony act, would forever despise phoniness of any kind, and refused to play along. She just headed for the kitchen to fetch the bottle of ammonia and a wet cloth. But afterward, her calm exit was the subject of talk. To the good folk of Chabot Court, she seemed an odd, cold sort of child. In truth, she was mortified. But Maggie would have done anything rather than give the tut-tutting local gossips the satisfaction of seeing her squirm. She was embarrassed by her parents' behavior, their noisy quarrels and bouts of drinking, and the odious conjecture it elicited. As she would bitterly recall, people were only too happy to have an excuse for feeling superior to those who broke from the norm. Any child newly arrived in America has an overwhelming desire for conformity, especially when it comes to family. Maggie yearned to fit in. Unfortunately, to their Oakland neighbors, her parents were an exhilaratingly exotic and endlessly diverting pair. Her mother filled the house with mementos of their sojourns in France and the Far East, watercolor prints, bright silk rugs, and carved jade figurines, which guaranteed people would regard her, like the decor, as different, foreign, and quaint. "I've never seen anyone like her," said Jean Craig, a childhood friend who grew up on the same street and attended Mass at the same Catholic church. "They were a strange, glamorous family, unlike any I'd ever known or ever would know." Maggie was conscious of her bizarre background, which she took to calling her Irish-French-Hong Kong heritage. Her attempts to blend in were frustrated by the fact that she spent the better part of the next few years in France with her aunts, who were like second mothers to her. Maggie divided her time between her Tante Genevieve's vineyard in Prisa, near Mâcon, and her Tante Juliette's home in Bournelles-sur-Seine, outside Paris. Because Marguerite wanted to start her education off right, Maggie began her schooling in France alongside her cousins. By the time she returned to the U.S. for good in 1927, she was bilingual and so far ahead of the other children that she skipped two grades. To make matters worse, conversation Shay Higgins tended to be a mixture of her mother's classic French, her father's soldier patois, and her own slightly accented English, with the occasional Chinese expression thrown in. When excited, Maggie never quite knew what was going to come out of her mouth. It was many years before she felt entirely comfortable speaking English. Despite her best efforts, even decades later, she would still catch herself slipping in some Gallic idiom left over from her youth. Always a slow writer who labored over her style and sentence construction, she envied those who, from the cradle, effortlessly acquired the rhythm and flow of their native tongue. When she first came to Chabot Court, Maggie felt like an outsider. She was teased mercilessly by the kids on the block, who mocked her broken English and ran after her, chanting insults, "Dirty Chinaman, dirty Chinaman, you were born in China." Furious and humiliated, Maggie would flee home to her father in tears. Larry, who was indifferent to convention but never to cowardice, taught her to never run from trouble. It was a matter of principle. He would turn her around and send her back outside to face her tormentors. Larry wanted her to have grit and to always be able to stand on her own two feet. "From the time she was little," he told an interviewer, "I tried to make her realize that she need never fear anything or any individual." Though still smarting, Maggie did as she was told. Above all, she wanted to please her father. Larry was convinced his daughter was special and took charge of preparing Maggie for the big future that awaited her. If he sometimes indulged her, it was because he saw in her qualities of his own. Her acumen and enormous vigor matched his, along with a ferocious inner drive. A reckless streak was in evidence early. When the kids on Chabot Court were all learning to ride their bicycles, Maggie was the first to try with no hands. She was also the first to master the perilous trick of riding with her feet on the handlebars, coasting round and round the circular drive in front of her house wearing a triumphant "look at me" grin. If anyone tried to race her, she approached hair-raising speeds. She was always good for a dare. "She led in exploits where we would often be cowering in the background," recalled a neighborhood playmate. Larry Higgins felt his daughter was not so much competitive as she was perfectionist, focused on achieving her own self-imposed goals. There was only one place for Marguerite, and that was the top, regardless of what she was doing, he said. But it was strictly for her own satisfaction, not to beat somebody else out. Her father helped her map a course of high achievement and instilled in her a confidence in her own judgment and a combative stance toward the naysayers in life. They spent hours together, happily engaged in any kind of activity that took them outdoors, from hiking and horseback riding to fishing and swimming. Like him, she was tall and slender, with a coltish physique that suggested both delicacy and strength. She became a wild tomboy, diving fearlessly into the crashing surf, looking back only to catch a glimpse of his nodded approval. If imprudence led her to go too far and she found herself flailing against the tide, he expected her to extract herself and know better the next time. No whining or whimpering was allowed. Maggie rose to every challenge he put to her, eager to be a contender. Years later, she would write of a similarly close father-daughter relationship. She preferred his company, and he in turn realized that a child so independent-minded and strong-willed needed a firm, guiding hand. Larry also imparted his enthusiasm for news of armed conflict around the globe, and together they followed the reports of the Japanese invasion of Manchuria in 1931, and 2 years later, the accounts of Hitler's coup in Germany. When the Spanish Civil War erupted in 1936, the writer Ernest Hemingway chronicled the fighting, and his dispatches were not to be missed. Maggie devoured Hemingway's novels. She promised herself that if there was another war, she would be there, if only to find out for herself what force cut so deeply into the hearts of men. As a brooding adolescent, she once angrily confronted her father about the discrepancy between his sentimental view of war and Hemingway's much darker vision, especially the sense of futility and loss described in the opening pages of A Farewell to Arms. It seemed to her that aviators were able to remain comfortably above the fray, unless they were shot down and plunged to their death, and knew nothing of the pain and suffering endured by the common fighting man. But this was just one of their running battles. They used to fight like cats and dogs, recalled a family member. They both felt so intensely about everything, and they both had an opinion on every subject, and they never agreed on anything, but liked each other a great deal. Maggie would always recollect her father with affection, but even in her carefully edited selection of childhood memories, her mother emerges as a stern, demanding figure. Like her husband, Marguerite was ambitious for their beautiful daughter, but a life of deprivation had robbed her of any illusions, so that her role in the family was that of critic and constant prod. She knew all too well that beauty could be ephemeral. It needed to be polished and carefully molded into something of lasting value. From the beginning, she was determined her child would have the best possible training, the best education, the best music lessons, the best dance lessons. Maggie shone with potential. She was a star. With the right opportunities and that face, she would go far. At various stages in her daughter's development, Marguerite was convinced she had produced a prima ballerina, a concert violinist, and a first-rate scholar. Larry and Marguerite gave their only child every advantage their precarious finances would allow. Then, in 1928, Larry lost his job when the Bank of Italy merged with the Bank of America and many of the employees were laid off. It was a cataclysmic event Maggie would always remember as the worst moment of her life. It knocked the foundations out from under her world, and the awful repercussions left her with a permanent sense of vulnerability, so that she never again felt entirely safe and secure. A few months later, the stock market crash wiped out what remained of their savings. Leary eventually found another position with a brokerage firm, but people had little left to invest, and business was slow. During the bleak Depression years, the Higgins family, like so many, was forced to economize. Accustomed to sacrifice, Marguerite found a way to supplement their income so her daughter would not have to do without. She began by tutoring the neighborhood children in French to pay for Maggie's ballet class as well as her violin and piano lessons. Then Marguerite took a job as a French teacher at the Anna Head School, an exclusive girls' academy, where she arranged for her daughter to be enrolled as a hardship case with the tuition fee waived. In January of 1930, a few months before her 10th birthday, Maggie entered the 6th grade at the Anna Head School. Named for its founder, a legendary progressive educator, the school was located near the Berkeley campus of Head's alma mater, the University of California, where she was among the first women graduates. One of the finest college preparatory programs in the Bay Area, the school attracted the daughters of California's best families. Maggie was never allowed to forget how fortunate she was to be afforded such a rare opportunity, and she struggled valiantly to prove herself worthy. Her mother expected her to justify her free education with long hours of study and academic excellence. "Every time my report card showed a B instead of straight A's, I risked the loss of scholarship," she recalled. "More important, any such flirtation with the second rate meant a real humdinger of a crisis at home." Her memory of those years are underpinned by a lingering resentment at the relentless pressure to perform. As soon as she completed her homework, Maggie was expected to put in 4 to 5 hours of daily practice on the violin, a routine rigidly enforced until the day she graduated. As a teenager, there were times when the oppressive grind became too much, and she found release in little fits of rebellion. Usually, this took the form of some harmless mischief or practical joke. These minor acts of insurrection resulted in poor marks for deportment, the only bad grades she received in high school. There were few such lapses in her self-imposed discipline. The need to earn her keep had been drilled into her early, pushing her to ever greater efforts to succeed, and inspiring even greater anxiety about whether she was good enough, had done enough, or had truly given it her all. The strain, she later noted, was hardly conducive to what psychologists would consider a stable personality or what is known as serenity. The tensions at home and the perpetual nagging worry about money magnified her self-doubt. At night, Maggie struggled to shut out her parents' escalating quarrels, the progress of which she could monitor from her bedroom by her father's thundering French, which would become louder and more incomprehensible in proportion to his outrage. In order to function, she turned inward. Gradually, she developed a kind of numbness, a form of control and self-defense. It allowed her to disengage from the domestic storms and concentrate on her studies. Her sensitivity to being a scholarship student at a school attended by some of the richest girls in California only accentuated her feelings of inadequacy, of always being the odd one out. She saw herself as a financial misfit among the likes of Diana Dollar of the Dollar Steamship Line family and Phyllis Head of the Hills Brothers Coffee Empire, who flouted their wealth and lived in sprawling mansions nestled in Oakland's foothills. Mercifully, Anna Head had a uniform. A no-nonsense gray pleated skirt and white blouse designed by the tennis player Helen Wills Moody, an alumna. In school, at least, she did not have to try to keep up with her posh classmates, with their stylish clothes and weekend shopping expeditions to San Francisco's gilded emporiums. Since she could not live up to their splendid standards, Maggie found other ways to shine. She excelled at sports, compelled by her competitive instinct and hunger for victory. Anna Head placed a premium on athletics. It boasted the most lavishly equipped gymnasium of any girls' academy on the West Coast, and had the first women's basketball team in the country. Winning was Maggie's route to acceptance and success. She went on to become a star athlete. Her school records show she channeled her prodigious energy into every kind of activity and contest. Junior year captain of the basketball team, senior year captain of the swim team, hockey, volleyball, and baseball teams, tennis, president of the athletic association, girl reserves, life-saving corps. A picture of the champion field hockey team shows Maggie in the center of a row of smiling girls, all brandishing their sticks. Her expression is portentous, resolute. Hips forward, head cocked provocatively, she stares down the camera. Maggie graduated at the top of her class. Although an honor student, her prizes were all for prowess on the field. At her June commencement, looking almost ethereal in a long white dress, her hair a crown of spun gold, she collected the athletic pin. At 16, the only sign she gave of any literary aspirations was revealed in a yearbook entry. Her stated goal in the horoscope section was to become a drama critic. For the probable end that every student was asked to imagine, she settled for court reporter. Journalism was not yet the focus of her ambition, but Maggie had already begun to mull the possibility that working for a newspaper might be a viable career. At the very least, it was a job that might get her out of Oakland. She later lamented that her bookworm status prevented her from having much of a social life. But her classmates recall that she was well-liked, had a friendly, outgoing personality, and was regarded very much as a leader. They remember a slender blonde with an enviable figure, big blue eyes like saucers, and a whispery voice. She was not the prettiest girl in her year, though she was very pretty. But there was something about Maggie. A singular air of self-assurance that made her stand out. It was a quality that made her seem equal to every occasion and up for anything. She was accorded the slightly odd respect of one who was seen as more experienced, or at least more in the know, when it came to boys than most girls their age. Apart from a few chaperoned dances, the only members of the opposite sex any of them spent time with were the boys from the neighborhood. Maggie had her pick of the motley crew. "It was pretty rough on us girls, unless she decided she didn't like a boy," recalled a friend. "They were all so crazy about her, we wouldn't have had a chance." Some school friends theorized that because Mrs. Higgins was French and not bound by the same strict Anglo-Saxon morality that governed their mother's every waking thought, she had more advanced ideas on sex. How else to explain Maggie's impish urge to shock? She did not shy away from the intimate or the indiscreet. Once, during a weekend outing with the YWCA, she scandalized her peers in the middle of a midnight gab session by suddenly asking who among them had gone the limit. Anne During was struck absolutely dumb by the boldness of her question. Such things were not openly discussed. Maggie thoroughly enjoyed their discomfort. But for all her apparent sophistication, her blasé attitude, During thought Maggie was probably just as naive as the rest of them. Though she had sometimes come out with what we thought were very worldly ideas. In the fall of 1937, Maggie enrolled in the University of California at Berkeley. To her great relief, she had been awarded a scholarship that would help defray the cost and leave her with enough money to cover her dormitory fees. A number of Anne Ahead graduates would be in the incoming freshman class, and the most pressing question facing the group was which sorority to pledge. Maggie and her friends spent the summer debating the pros and cons of each house, meticulously planning their wardrobes for rush week, and nervously anticipating the round of alumni receptions, lunches, and teas during which the girls and their mothers would be carefully vetted. Newspaper clippings, neatly pasted in her scrapbook, record the giddy succession of parties that autumn, held in a sweltering heat wave. Maggie's set aspired to Alpha Phi, which, while not at the pinnacle of the social order, was only a rung or two below. To her infinite regret, Maggie did not make the cut. She was not recruited by Alpha Phi, where her friends delightedly pledged. She was blackballed. She professed not to care, but privately, Maggie was disconsolate. She hid her hurt at the bitchy speculation about the reasons for her ostracism. It might have been her family's Catholicism, her mother's pronounced French accent, or their small house on the wrong side of Oakland. In any event, the thin-lipped committee had concluded the Higgins family did not quite rate. It was Maggie's first public failure, and it stung. Phoebe True, a friend who pledged Alpha Phi, observed that while Maggie prided herself on her individualism, she desperately wanted to be part of the in-crowd. While her old companions became caught up in the social whirl, Maggie quietly went her own way. She made a show of going through the motions for the first year, then drifted from the scene. The whole tedious and trivial pageant had lost its charm for her. If the ultimate goal of sorority life was to meet the right fraternity boy, there was more than one way to win at that game. She plunged into the campus social life with an almost vengeful spirit. Soon, all the boys were after her. She quickly earned a reputation as a party girl, according to Billy Jones, a fellow member of the class of 41. She tended to have a good time all the time. She didn't seem very serious-minded. One thing she was serious about, however, was trying out for the college paper, the Daily Californian, which was one of the best student-edited publications in the country and wielded considerable influence. Editorial board appointments were highly sought after. Freshmen were relegated to gopher jobs and proofreading and were expected to work their way up the ranks. Competition was stiff, and frequent staff cuts designed to weed out the slackers kept them on their toes. Maggie surprised her friends by being very keen from the start. She worked herself ragged. Her first byline, an interview with the illustrious English novelist W. Somerset Maugham, was so gratifying she made up her mind to become a journalist and, without fail, a career woman. She devoted so much time and energy to working on the paper that she paid little attention to her appearance, often turning up to meals in wrinkled clothes, her blonde curls askew. One day, Jean Craig bumped into her emerging from the basement offices of the Daily Cal at full speed, wearing one blue sock and one white, with apparently no knowledge of her attire. The newspaper and its select hierarchy became all-consuming for her. Anne During, who also hoped for a reporter slot, was struck by Maggie's almost desperate need to prove herself. She studied the older students whose efforts made it into print with a kind of feral envy, as though her very survival depended on it. Edmund Antrobus, who worked on the Daily Cal and later became a war correspondent, admired her burning desire to improve, and recalled her being so intent on honing her writing skills that she asked a mutual friend for advice. Others, who were initially flattered by her interest, grew wary and learned not to leave notes on their desk. Maggie, some said, had a habit of biting the hand that mentored her. In June of her freshman year, Maggie got a summer job at Yosemite National Park. She would be waiting tables in the dining room at Camp Curry, which would allow her to spend several months in the mountains while still earning enough to pay her college expenses. When Jean Kelly, a high school friend who was in her class at Berkeley, learned she would also be working at Yosemite, the two girls began excitedly making plans. When Kelly's mother overheard an offhand comment that changed her mind about letting her daughter go, in the course of propounding her latest theory on the merits of unmarried sex, Maggie had argued that their time away presented an ideal opportunity to gain some invaluable experience, asserting in a tone of irrefutable logic, "You wouldn't buy a horse without riding him." Kelly's mother did not approve. She informed Jean that Maggie was perhaps a bit too mature, and it might be better if she did not accompany her to Yosemite. When Jean saw her friend again that August, there was no doubt Maggie had enjoyed a very equestrian summer. She had discovered Bertrand Russell and was an advocate of free love. By her sophomore year, Maggie was experimenting with new ideas and testing the limits of her newfound freedom. She did just enough to maintain the grade point average required by her scholarship, played the violin in the orchestra, participated in the little theater plays, and still found time for a hectic romantic life. She openly flaunted her sexual liaisons, picked up and discarded boyfriends at a dizzying pace, and brazenly thumbed her nose at middle-class propriety. In an era of chaperoned parties and strict curfews, Maggie broke all the rules. Her flagrant disregard of the sorority house sign-out system and general lack of decorum raised eyebrows and brought her before the university's judicial committee for violating the code of conduct for women. Unconcerned, she penned a series of spirited letters to the editor of the Daily Cal, suggesting it was time Berkeley co-eds considered broadening their outlook, and announcing her interest in carving out a role for herself unconstrained by the gender limitations placed on previous generations. In one wickedly sardonic missive, she made fun of the boys who fretted that the household science majors were less interested in getting an education than in looking for a husband. While that might be the case, Maggie taunted, the UC Berkeley boys had no reason to hide, as they were hardly marriage material. She advised the poor little fellows to stop quivering in their boots for fear some girl will scoop them up. Her budding feminism was not ideological as much as an innate attitude. She simply did not believe that men were better at anything than she was. And she did not want the fact that she was a woman to mean that she would be treated any differently. The suggestion that she might be in college pursuing anything other than a degree infuriated her. The male students quickly learned not to be taken in by her sweet appearance. At first glance, she had the face of an angel, but she was earning a reputation on campus of being something of a hellion. Her old circle of friends was not sure what to make of this new, rambunctious, spiky side to Maggie. While they regarded it as just another phase, it was, nonetheless, disquieting. Raised to believe that women could not be too careful, and that a large part of their future married life would be determined by their present associations, they were alarmed by the change in her behavior. She was moving too far, too fast. "We were a very protected, conservative, properly raised, and properly conducted bunch of young ladies," explained Marjorie Barker, who was in the same pledge group at Gamma Phi Beta. "She had what we considered to be a very liberal viewpoint on dating and politics. Today, no one would give her conduct a second thought," she added. But back then, Maggie was years ahead of her time. Under the influence of a series of left-wing beaux, Maggie began flirting with campus politics. Inspired by the idealistic spirit of Franklin Roosevelt's New Deal, she was among an increasing number of students in the 30s who were concerned about the social injustice, unemployment, and hardship endured by so many during the Depression. She was animated by a sincere belief that her generation could forge a better society. The economic panacea envisaged by socialism made enough of an impact on her that she wrote a long essay in which she argued fervently that the abolition of poverty would do away with thievery and greed. Her conscience had been aroused, in part, by two brilliant and charismatic Berkeley professors. Haakon Chevalier, who taught French literature and was one of the most liberal and outspoken members of the predominantly conservative faculty, and Stanley Moore, a handsome young teaching assistant in the philosophy department who was active in the student movement. Tall and blonde, with the chiseled features of a Greek god, Chevalier was the Pied Piper of radical Berkeley campus politics. He and his wealthy wife gave large parties at their spectacular hilltop home, which became the informal center of left-wing college society, not to mention the local Communist Party. He mixed with highbrow luminaries, from the physicist Robert Oppenheimer to the playwright Lillian Hellman, as well as assorted intellectuals, artists, poets, and actors. Maggie frequented his political salon, reading the books he loaned her on Hobbes, Rousseau, and Hegel, and listened to him preach about labor unions and civil rights. Chevalier thought she showed great promise and considered her to be one of the bright lights on campus. To Maggie, the 24-year-old Moore was an especially intriguing figure. She first encountered him the fall of her freshman year when he led her philosophy section. He had received his BA from Berkeley in 1935, was elected to Phi Beta Kappa, spent a year at Harvard immersed in philosophy, and then returned to the University of California to continue his graduate studies, teach, and work on his doctorate. Descended from a wealthy, prominent San Francisco family with the lanky good looks of a matinee idol, he was someone her mother would have considered a good catch. He was also an avowed Marxist and a member of the Young Communist League. Moore believed that, in a time of upheaval and engagement around the world, he and his fellow students needed to take a stand. "Fascism and communism seemed the main combatants," he recalled of his youthful ardor, "and the positions in between seemed rather pale by comparison." Maggie was captivated by him. Her friends thought Stanley Moore and his politics were pretty far out. One pal could not resist remarking that Maggie's interest in the cause extended only to those meetings where the men are. In the fall of 1939, Maggie became increasingly caught up in the strident anti-fascist debates and emotionally charged anti-war protests that rocked Berkeley's campus. On September 1, German troops marched into Poland. 2 days later, Britain and France, both allies of the invaded nation, fulfilled their vow to declare war rather than allow further German expansion. Stunned by the disastrous turn of events, some political leaders were insisting that only American intervention could save Europe from Nazi domination. A bitter dispute erupted on campus between the isolationists and interventionists, and Maggie was in the middle of it. She reacted against the increasing hysteria of Allied sympathizers like her parents and sided with the peace lovers. Committed to the idea that another war would solve nothing, she campaigned vigorously against mandatory conscription and handed out pacifist leaflets. As the news from Europe worsened, she and the other reporters on the Daily Cal scrambled to cover the political unrest on campus and abroad. The student publication challenged the establishment and frequently tussled with the administration. Their reporting took on a new importance. "It was very tense," recalled James Poole, a classmate and senior editor on the paper. "We were teetering on the edge of war. We were under a lot of pressure." Maggie scored her first big feature in February 1940 in a special two-part article on the rumblings of revolution in Mexico. The stories were based on her observations of the country where, during the 3-week Christmas break, she had gone on vacation, accompanied by no less than the paper's roguish managing editor, Rainey Reed. In Mexico, No Bed of Roses, Maggie reported, "There are no elections as we conceive of them in the United States. The government candidate always wins, no matter who is the people's choice." It was a coup for a junior. But it was Maggie's repeated use of the royal "we" in the piece that confounded her colleagues. Was this the editorial "we"? Or was she brazenly telegraphing her latest conquest? Rainey Reed was smitten. Rumors spread that he had proposed. What few people knew was that Maggie had come back from their holiday jaunt to Mexico pregnant. Only 19, she was adamant that she did not want to get married, and she did not want a baby. After a tense family council, the decision was made that Larry would drive her to Phoenix, Arizona, where there were reliable, if illegal, abortion clinics. Predictably, her mother was beside herself. It was difficult to tell what bothered Marguerite more, the church's moral strictures, the social embarrassment, or the risks associated with the medical procedure. Maggie put up a brave front. Her predicament was hardly unique. Gossip columns often hinted at the Hollywood starlets who frequented Arizona clinics, registering under assumed names and recovering in nearby motels. She returned to college chastened, but unbowed. There is no record of her pain or regret, save a confession to a close friend years later that she had undergone one too many terminations in her youth. Maggie did not allow herself to dwell on past mistakes. With characteristic fortitude and determination, she moved forward. She would not indulge in self-pity. "What's done is done," she would always say, never one to agonize once she had settled on a course of action. The loss of innocence had been violently swift. She had thought she was ready for everything life could throw at her. But she did not emerge from the experience unscathed in body or spirit. Her anger sustained her. Anger at her ignorance and at the implied shame of her ordeal. Her rebellion against her parents' petit bourgeois values now took a new form. She threw herself into the radical student movement, giving vent to all her rage and frustration. She began hanging out with members of the Young Communist League. Then, she latched on to Fred Vast, a journalism student who wrote for the People's Daily World, the official Communist Party newspaper, who convinced her to take part in their campus rallies. Despite her high-pitched little girl's voice, Maggie discovered an aptitude for public speaking. She joined in the student demonstrations against the coming war in Europe and the peacetime draft. She had her father's flair for bombast, and she liked being the main attraction. On September 3, 1940, several of her former Anna Head classmates were astounded at the sight of Maggie giving a fiery speech, practically on a soapbox, at Sathergate on Telegraph Hill, surrounded by other dissenters, directly attacking university president Robert Gordon Sproul for his announcement that he would not tolerate student opposition to the national defense effort, she insisted on their right to freedom of speech. "There is much talk about it being unpatriotic to oppose conscription," she declared. "I think it's unpatriotic to threaten to expel students because they oppose conscription." Some members of the contentious crowd of spectators booed. A few fraternity men hurled rotten tomatoes. Maggie, slim and erect, her face pinched with embarrassment, remained defiant. Her sorority sisters were appalled to see one of their own making such a spectacle of herself. They took it as proof that she had morphed into a pink communist type. When the incident made the local papers, Maggie was chastised by a covey of sorority house officers for giving their chapter a bad name. After that, she severed all ties with Gamma Phi Beta, though by then the antipathy was mutual. Maggie followed up with an unapologetic column in the Daily Cal, stating that the frat boys had ended up with ketchup on their faces because their tomato-throwing faux pas had resulted in far more publicity for the radicals' cause. Her father, a dyed-in-the-wool Republican.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.